from the CBS Bay Area studios, this is KPIX 5 News.
Now on KPIX 5 News, a pair of large wildfires has expanded, forcing new evacuations in Lake and Colusa counties.
And dueling protests in Portland, a pro-Trump group and an alt-right group planned a demonstration and were met by Antifa counter-protesters. And similar protests are planned in the Bay Area later today. It's 6 a.m. on Sunday, August 5th. Good morning. I'm Melissa Caen.
And I'm Julie Watts. Devin's got the morning off. And we're going to start this morning with a check of the forecast. Starting off with a look at the satellite. High pressure still in place, keeping temperatures warm inland. In fact, we're going to see temperatures topping out in the mid-90s near some of our fire zones today. So keeping a close eye on fire weather. Back here, closer to the bay, waking up to this view from Sutro Tower. As you can see, the clouds have rolled in. We are off to a cloudy start, but a beautiful sunrise up above the low cloud deck this morning. And that, of course, is over the bay, over San Francisco. Temperatures right now topping out in the low 60s for some of the warmer spots as you head out the door this morning. Concord right now at 63, as well as San Jose. Oakland at 55, 57 in Livermore right now, 54 San Francisco, and 50 degrees currently in Santa Rosa. Futurecast showing we're starting off socked in, but the clouds will pull back to the coast later today. We'll get sunshine for most throughout the day today. We're going to see cool conditions if you're heading out to the Stern Grove Festival today, topping out near 60 degrees there. Fremont Festival of the Arts, a little bit warmer there. And up north in Santa Rosa for the Sonoma County Fair, 92 degrees. Anticipate some smoke in the air and poor air quality up north. We'll talk more about that coming up. In fact, for more on the fires, here's Melissa.
That's right. Evacuation orders have now spread to two more counties as the Mendocino Complex fires continue to grow. The Ranch and River fires have been burning for more than a week in Mendocino and Lake counties. And yesterday, people in more parts of those counties, as well as areas of Glenn and Colusa counties, were told to evacuate. The Mendocino Complex fires have been quite destructive. Combined, the fires have destroyed 55 homes. In addition, 49 other buildings have burned, and CAL FIRE says more than 15,000 buildings are currently threatened. And clouds of smoke keep rising over the region. It's an eerie reminder of the seriousness of the situation. Crews say a major problem is the combination of low humidity, high winds, and burning embers flying through the air.
Every ember lights a spot fire. It's a 100% probability of ignition. So that's creating huge issues for us, because if you get 100 embers that land in a particular area, they all start a fire and they start a new head fire on us, literally, in that particular location, and it runs at us and sometimes runs us out of locations.
The Ranch fire, which started near Potter Valley, is the larger of the two fires. It has burned more than 181,000 acres. The containment has actually dropped. It's down now to just 22%. And the smaller River fire, which began near Hopland, has burned more than 47,000 acres and is 50% contained. Of course, smoke from those two fires is lingering in parts of the Bay Area. Now, visibility wasn't a huge issue yesterday, but you could see the haze, and an air quality advisory is in effect through the weekend.
Well, Governor Brown got a firsthand look at the damage caused by the Carr wildfire in Shasta County, as the seventh death was linked to that fire yesterday. The governor announced he's seeking federal help to fight statewide fires and recover from another difficult wildfire season.
I've asked the president to make a major declaration.
Now, the governor said he was confident the president will send aid, even though the two have clashed over policies related to immigration and pollution.
These kind of horrible situations bring people together, regardless of the lesser kind of ideologies and partisan considerations.
The latest death linked to the Carr wildfire is a PG&E employee who was killed in a car accident while working to restore service. The fire has destroyed more than 1,000 homes in Shasta County. It's burned more than 145,000 acres and is 41% contained.
Our new evacuations in Mariposa County as the Ferguson wildfire has reached some of the remote areas of Yosemite National Park. And the fire has burned more than 81,000 acres and is just 35% contained. Yosemite Valley resident Dakota Snyder took this video when he was forced to evacuate after the flames jumped from Highway 41. Snyder and his fellow evacuees are staying with friends until it's safe to drive back to their homes. He says most of them already had their bags packed when pre-evacuation orders were issued last week.
The smoke over the last month has been really intense, and we've had fires before, we've had evacuations before, but to have this extended period of just this inversion layer of just hazardous, unbreathable air, it takes its toll.
A Tenaya Lodge, which normally accommodates tourists, is now housing some of the firefighters and local evacuees. And several road closures remain in effect, including portions of Highway 41, 120, and 140. And two firefighters have lost their lives battling the Ferguson fire. Yesterday, colleagues led a funeral procession through the streets of Fresno to honor one of those fallen heroes. 33-year-old Brian Hughes was struck and killed by a falling tree last Sunday as he worked along the eastern edge of the fire. He left behind a fiance who is 3 months pregnant. The other fallen firefighter was 36-year-old Braden Varney. The 10-year Cal Fire veteran was killed on July 14th when his bulldozer rolled over in steep terrain.
About 60 miles north, a new wildfire has already taken out 1,700 acres of the Stanislaus National Forest. The Donnell Fire is burning off Highway 108 in Tuolumne County. It sparked Wednesday. At last check, there was no containment.
And it's happened again, another double stabbing on a BART train. The suspect is still on the run. A BART police say that this man, 27-year-old Solomon Espinoza, attacked two men with a box cutter. Security cameras on a Richmond-bound train captured it on Friday night. Espinoza got off at the MacArthur station and may be a transient in that area. And police say Espinoza did not know the victims. Now, one of them had cuts to his face. The other had his arm slashed. But both men are expected to recover from their injuries.
Well, in other news, the city of Berkeley is preparing for potential clashes today between far-left and far-right protesters. Right-wing activists plan what they describe as an anti-communist rally at MLK Civic Center Park. Signs and barricades began going up there yesterday. Antifa, a self-described anti-fascist group, is expected to hold a counter-rally at a nearby park. Now, north of the state line, scuffles broke out in Portland during similar dueling protests yesterday involving Antifa and the far-right group Patriot Prayer and Proud Boys. Now, police had to deploy flashbang devices, as you just heard there, and took other measures to keep the situation under control. Four people were arrested during the protest, and a newspaper reporter was injured by a projectile. It's been almost a year since Patriot Prayer and Antifa faced off here in Berkeley. Last September, three people were arrested as the right-wing group marched on Cal's campus. About 100 people were there at the time. Berkeley police have released a list of banned items ahead of today's rally, and they include metal pipes, baseball bats, explosives, or generally anything that can be used as a weapon. Well, it's a new twist on Seattle's iconic Space Needle, and it's called The Loop. At the top of the observation deck, 50 stories up, the Space Needle is getting a rotating glass floor, giving visitors a complete 360 view of the city. Now, the Loop is powered by 12 different motors and is said to be the world's first revolving glass floor. The Space Needle building, which was completed in 1962, is currently undergoing a $100 million renovation.
Hey, good morning, everybody. Here's how we do it. We do it really quickly when it comes to morning sports right here on the show. So without further ado, let's just roll it up. Oh, man, I don't know how many spin classes it would take to work this off. Man, Tigers at bat against the A's yesterday, and Detroit struck first. Jamer Candelario, a first-inning RBI single, but a run last night, not going to be enough. Bottom of the third, Matt Chapman, and that's where the big boys put him. Dead center, tied the game. Next batter, Chris Davis, or Crush Davis. A back-to-back number, third straight 30-homer season for him. A's won it 2-1. Meantime, in the desert, Giants' Andrew Suarez roughed up at Arizona. Just didn't go well. First inning, Ketel Marte, a monster home run. Giants gave up 5 runs in the first frame for the second straight game. Bottom of the fifth, more carnage. Mr. Ahmed, a 2-run shot. I think you've seen enough. Giants lost this game, final of 9-3. But back to the American League for a second for me, as the Seattle Mariners lost yesterday. So in the wild card race, the A's hold that second spot. Their lead over Seattle now 2.5 games on that one. And congratulations to Livermore Little League this morning. Boy, you got to be feeling really good on the strength of becoming the U.S. champs for Little League Intermediate World Series last night, beating a team from Florida 5-1. They'll play later on today, a 6 p.m. start against Asia Pacific for the whole enchilada. That's enough. We'll see you later.